Good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure having all of you on this Saturday afternoon, first Saturday of New Year 2021. It's been a torrid 2020 ever since the pandemic had struck, and the markets have been on a different zone altogether. So I think it's been a profound year on what COVID has really taught us. But in that context, what really goes forward, I think, is something to be seen and something to be witnessed. I'm Mayuresh Joshi, Head of Equity Research at William O'Neill India. Welcome you all and wish everyone a very happy, healthy and a safe 2021. With this background and context, we have started a series from this year called Walk the Stock. So we'll be featuring prominent market voices, market veterans, persons who have seen markets in all forms, have seen all the cycles of the market in the past few decades, and they will help us decode the entire perspective and the positioning that we are in. Currently, I think we're going through a torrid time, as I said, and therefore I think what the global cues will give us are going to be extremely critical. I have great pleasure, and you can see Nilesh Bhai on the screen, that 2021, the first person who's gracing this occasion with William O'Neill on Walk the Stock is Nilesh Shah. Absolutely astute in his field over the past few decades. Brilliant personality, has impeccable knowledge when it comes to asset classes, and he's got a distinguished academic record as well. So gold medalist in the chartered accountancy field, cost accountancy field, and many, many accolades in his previous stints as well. So I don't need to introduce him, but again, the managing director of Kotak Mahindra AMC and his earlier stints with Axis, ICICI Asset Management, Franklin Templeton, and his talk views are very well known to all of us. So welcome, Nilesh Bhai. Thank you for taking time out on this Saturday. And it'll be a very, very enriching session for all of us to understand from you the current market situation and what you've seen in the past as well. And a very, very happy New Year to you, the entire team at your asset management firm and all your family members. Wishing them a healthy, happy and safe 2021.
Thank you, Mayuresh. Wish you and everyone on the call and their loved ones a happy and healthy 2021.
Great. So without further ado, Nilesh Bhai, I think we'll jump straight into what we are here for, to discuss where we are, what the positioning is. So straight out of the book, as I said in my opening remarks, we started the year with a black swan event like a COVID crisis, which hit us pretty hard. But the recovery was one of the fastest that we've ever seen in earlier cycles as well. So I think the question, Nilesh Bhai, that comes to everybody's mind is this really sustainable? Okay, images aate hain WhatsApp pe with the bull is stationed on top of the BSE building, and people are really wondering on how far that bull can really go from there onwards. So how have you seen this rally so far, and what has been your experience in previous market cycles in consumers?
So for any market to sustain, you require three things. One, sentiment should be positive, flows should be strong, and ultimately both should be backed by fundamentals. When sentiments are bad, flows are negative, and fundamentals are deteriorating, we see mother of a bear market. And on the opposite side, we see mother of a bull market. Now, in the month of March, FPI sold 60,000 crore. COVID-19 induced lockdown, and we were facing uncertainty sitting at our home. And because of lockdown, corporate earnings crashed, factories were shut, businesses were shut. We saw 7,500 Nifty. At that point of time, no one in social media put a bear on top of stock exchange. Now we have seen FPIs buying 60,000 crore in the month of November and December. Sentiments are bullish as you are going out and trying to lead a normal life. And September quarterly results did improve fundamentals. We are at 14,000. People who have been left out of this rally, they are the guys who are probably putting out bull on the index and saying that I don't know how have I reached here. The students of the market, participants of the market, they have accepted that markets are markets. They will move from bull to bear phase. It's a normal cycle. Now, as student of the market, we have to figure out what will drive this market in 2021. From March bottom to December 20, we are up by almost 100%. I'm just rounding off number. 7,500 to 14,000 is not 100%, but just round off the numbers. Certainly, that kind of return is not going to come in 2021. That I'm sure about it. Yeah. Now, returns will moderate in 2021 compared to bottom of 22 current level. But what will drive it? The most important thing is fundamentals. Now, in the month of June quarter, when profit after tax was declared for Nifty 50 companies, number came at about 45,000 crore. In September quarter end, people were expecting number of 75,000-80,000 crore. Actual number came at 110,000 crore. This is the highest ever quarterly profit by India Inc. And this is when sales are down 7% in a quarter. Now, if this run rate sustains at 110,000 crore, we are looking at a profit after tax of 440,000 crore for next year. At current market cap, Nifty is trading then at 24 times forward earning, not 35, 36 or 38 as people are talking about based on June number. So most important thing for markets to run in 2021 is sustainability of corporate earnings. If companies deliver results like September, markets will deliver positive return. If companies fail to maintain this momentum and their profitability comes down, then there will be correction in market.
Great. So a follow-up question, Nilesh bhai, on this. Even if you assume, and as you rightly pointed out, that earnings ultimately will drive how the market direction will be, to a large extent, do you believe that the earnings growth that a lot of analysts are pegging in 2 years henceforth, or even in the next year with a low base of this year, which will happen, is that not getting factored into market valuations right now?
Undoubtedly, it gets factored into market valuation, and which is why it is trading at 24 times. So it's not that market has not discounted positives. Market is always forward-looking and it keeps on discounting all the positives. When PMI number came above 50, it was positive. When GST collection crossed 1,15,000 crore lifetime high, it was positive. When electricity consumption went up to 1,82,000 megawatts, it was the highest ever electric consumption, it was positive. So market is discounting positive, there's no doubt about it.
Great to hear that. But then again, I think macro indicators, Nilesh, as you are saying, if they are really on the mend, is there a sustainable factor on the kind of numbers that will still get posted, or do you see some kind of an underlying risk to the same?
See, there will be always risk. 2020 has taught us humility. In the month of Jan, did we have any idea what will happen in March? And it was not as if COVID-19 was not in the news. Despite it being in the news, despite seeing what was happening in China, Wuhan, we couldn't predict how it will impact global economy. At the bottom of the market, we were all talking about staying invested, putting more money as valuations had become cheaper. But did any one of you know that we will close the year at 14,000? Hand on heart, I can say that at least I was not predicting that. So we have to be humble to the market. There will be ups, there will be downs. The biggest risk for 2021 continues to remain vaccine. If 2020 was virus and volatility, 2021 is vaccine and volatility. If more and more vaccines continue to come on stream, more and more people get vaccinated, it will support the market. But if mutation of virus occurs and we see lockdown like UK, Tokyo, US, then certainly markets will get impacted. So be ready for unexpected. That's the lesson of 2020. But at the same time, please remember that in stock market, it is optimist who makes money. The bear, the pessimist may get intelligent things to say, but it is the optimist which will make money.
Oh, absolutely, Neelaj bhai. In fact, our founder, William O'Neill, has a very famous quote that in his entire life cycle of 70 years in the US market, he has quoted that he has never met a successful pessimist. So again, driving your point forward. On the risk factors and the underlying risk elements that you mentioned, Neelaj bhai, let me come to the first part. There has been a lot of printing of money globally that has been happening over the last few quarters and last few months. And now it is a presumption that if anything goes wrong, the first thing is to print money and get out of trouble by doing that. Now, at some stage, this printing will stop. How will the markets react, and will they have a reaction for a few months earlier in anticipation of that? And how do you perceive once the liquidity starts ebbing off in terms of equity market?
So there are too many ifs and buts into it. If you read book Lords of Finance, which talked about Great Depression era central bankers, it was almost believed that depression became Great Depression because that era central bankers withdrew stimulus early.
Yeah.
I'm sure all central bankers around the world have read that book, and they will be careful in withdrawing stimulus.
Yes.
Second, if we go by Bank of Japan experience, which started stimulating economy through liquidity, printing of money, cutting interest rates since 1990, till today, they have not withdrawn the stimulus. In fact, they are like, you know, popular series Star Trek, to go where no man has gone before. So they were the first one to pump liquidity, then US Fed and ECB followed. They were the first one to bring interest rates to zero, then US Fed, ECB and other central bankers followed. They are the first one to own equity in Japanese companies, and now Bank of Japan is the largest owner of equity. US Fed, ECB are taking baby steps towards that direction. RBI is miles away to move in that direction. So limited point here is that central bankers will be like doctor. They knew when they will time it perfectly, when to remove ventilator out of a dying patient. They will know when to remove glucose and blood bottles when the patient has recovered. They will not remove everything at one go to lose what they have already achieved. So there will be fairness in their withdrawal of stimulus. If they move too early, we will have risk of, again, volatility and correction. But I will put my money that they will do it fairly.
Super. Great to hear that, Neelaj bhai. On the second element of earnings that you spoke about, that you really need to be, the markets really need to be cognizant in terms of how earnings will play out. So there is a optimistic hope that earnings will grow at a very decent pace, as a lot of analysts are pegging on this street. Now, you're absolutely right in saying that there has to be a realistic approach in the next two quarters, and if it doesn't match those expectations, you might see some sort of pain in the markets. So how are you pegging in earnings recovery for India Inc., not just from the next two quarters perspective, but with your expertise and what you've seen in earlier cycles, on how the next 2 to 3 years will play out for India Inc.?
So, see, one has to be always cautious in predicting future. But at the same time, you have no option but to predict future with optimism.
Correct.
I believe Indian corporates' earnings will be on solid ground. In September quarter, they went up 17% year on year, despite sales coming down 7%. I believe lower interest rates, higher liquidity, normalizing economic activity, and most importantly, stringent cost cutting, which this pandemic taught us, will all help India Inc. to deliver better profit. Now, can we take it for granted? Answer is yes, subject to medical situation does not creating another lockdown. That is beyond us. But if normal economic activity continues, then certainly we are in far better shape to deliver higher profit now than last year. Will the recovery be even across all the sectors? Answer is no. Some sectors will do well, some will not. Will within sector companies deliver same level of profitability? Answer is no. There are some companies which are doing lip service on cost cutting. There are some companies which have gone with intensity on cost cutting. There are some companies which have been adopted to new reality. They are still working with old mindset. There are some companies which have become digital native from physical native in this pandemic. So each company will have different trajectory. Each sector will have different trajectory. But overall, India Inc. will continue to see better profit growth subject to this medical situation.
Absolutely agree, Nilesh Bhai. Now, coming to that point of the sectors that you spoke about, 2020 largely belonged to a lot of sectors at play. So, IT, pharma had a good run in 2020. What are your sustainable themes, in your opinion, that 2021 will work out with? Is it more economic-facing sectors which have largely been beaten down, where economic recovery can come back, or some other themes which have played out in 2020 might continue, or a mix of both?
So if we look at on a broad basis, if there is disruption in normal economic activity due to any reason, then defensive sectors like IT, pharma, FMCG will do well. On the other end, if month-on-month economy keeps on picking up steam, then cyclicals like commodities will do well. The second one is sectors which will do well, but it's already priced in. For example, chemicals, contract manufacturing, they will show higher growth in 21, but that's already factored into prices to a great extent. Unless until they deliver above expectation, their stock prices will not move as much. One sector where we are very bullish is home improvement. Most of us have worked from home in last 9 months.
Yes.
And somewhere the wear and tear is visible. People are bored looking at the same paint. Tiles have taken out somewhere. Fans are not working. Lights have gone out. White goods have been used extensively, so they need change. Now, in many of our homes, you know, we call contractor laborer to do it. And because of pandemic, we didn't open our house to outsider, except for emergencies. As we move into 2021 and with vaccination, our houses open, we will be calling all these contractors for home improvement. Each one will do improvement according to their requirement. On the other hand, this pandemic also taught us that we are one room short of in our houses. It didn't matter whether you had 10 bedroom house or one bedroom house, everyone was one room short. So there is primary demand happening on residential side. In Mumbai, courtesy stamp duty, but 20,000 registrations happened.
Yes.
In other places, same news is visible. Now put these two things together. Anyone buying new house will do improvements. Anyone staying in old house is also likely to do improvements. There will be pent-up demand as well as primary demand for home improvement items. Paints, tiles, fittings, furniture, fixture, electric connections, consumer durables, cement. All this sector will get lifted in terms of growth as well as profitability in 2021. And their shares have partially started reflecting this pent-up demand and primary demand. But I wouldn't say like chemical sector, it has factored in everything. So home improvement could be a good opportunity in the days to come.
Oh, absolutely, Nilesh Bhai. Point taken. In fact, my own instance, if I should cite that, I'm working from a room and that extra room is always needed because wife is working from a room and my kid has online classes. In fact, the messaging is such that we actually share on WhatsApp, let's meet for lunch at 1:30. So I absolutely agree to your entire thesis that you have been putting forth. But again, I think coming back to the point, is there some profit booking if investors are sitting on, say, from some sectors which have moved significantly, like IT, pharma? Should they be booking profits is the question that has been on everybody's mind. And should they wait for a correction? Should they be booking out of leaders within the individual spaces? Or even the missed out feeling that you spoke about in your opening remarks, if some individuals have not got in, is it the right time? And what should be the strategy for such individuals if they have not properly entered the market and have been on the sidelines over the last 2 weeks?
See, in some sense, stock market investing is like driving. It depends upon your skill set. I don't know driving. It doesn't matter what kind of car you give to me. I will be a bad driver. I should not venture into it. For that kind of investor, mutual funds are far better. Then there is a learning license driver. Ideally, he should not go to highway at the first attempt. Try to hone your skill in city roads, quiet roads. And then once you get confidence, once you get experience, make an attempt on small patch of highway, especially when traffic is not there. And then slowly, slowly you go to highway. On the other hand, there are experienced drivers. Well, they can do all kinds of lane maneuvering. They can move from slow lane to fast lane, back to slow lane. They can overtake. Now, if I try to, you know, do overtaking on highway, I will be dead because I don't even know driving. So one, don't try to judge that because Mr. X is driving so well on highway, I should just pick up the car and move on. You will be dead. Mm. For average investor, instead of looking at stock, they should be looking at their allocation. If you are overweight equity at this point of time, it is time to book profit. Please come back to equal weight because this market is no longer cheap. It was cheap in March 2020, April 2020, May 2020, June 2020, but certainly not today. If you are underweight equity, you have to invest today despite current valuation. Because you are not investing for today, tomorrow, day after tomorrow, you are investing for long term. And there will be ups and downs, but then you have to catch the running train rather than standing on platform. It all depends upon your risk profile, your investment objective, and your allocation, whether you should be booking profit today or whether you should be investing despite the sharp run-up.
Absolutely. Point taken, Nilesh bhai. Now, the other question that perennially keeps on coming, specifically from a retail or a high net worth individual as well, is if you want to enter specific stocks on our own, am I better off if I'm a moderate risk taker and I've got a medium-term appetite in terms of a 2 to 3 year time horizon? Should I be better off with large caps, mid caps, small caps? Because the quest, Nilesh bhai, is that everybody wants to find multi-baggers or pursue multi-baggers. So what should be the ideal allocation if direct investing has to happen between large caps, mid caps and small caps?
So again, it is to your skill set. If you are an average investor with common sense, that's good enough license to invest into stock market. I'll give you an example. A friend's father was working in a CA firm in Mumbai in the 70s and 80s and 90s. And in those days, there was physical delivery. So his partners used to trade. This guy was just a clerk. And he used to carry their contract notes from here to there. He used to account their contract note. He used to see their delivery and so on and so forth. By simply observing his partner's trade, he realized what was working and what was not working. And in his meager salary, he started investing in quality companies and holding on to them. In the 90s, when he retired, his net worth was higher than his partner's. So imagine in the 60s to 70s to 90s, CA firm head clerk, what kind of salary he would be getting. By commonsensical investing, observing from his partner's mistake, he made more money than his partner's. This is the power of common sense. India's topmost investor is not IIT, IIM or a chartered accountant. He's just Bachelor of Commerce.
Yes.
It's his sense of observation. It's his sense of discipline which has made him money. So there is no prerequisite to be a successful investor with, you know, professional education, expertise, and so on and so forth. Simple common sense and discipline is good enough. But you must take care of your portfolio. You can't say, fill it, shut it, forget it. No. You have to invest and observe. When you plant a seed, you water it daily. You protect it in the initial stages from stray animals. You ensure that fertilizer is put, pesticide is put, and then that becomes a giant tree. Same thing is about portfolio. You buy good company, stay with it, but continue to nurture it through observation. What was a blue chip company in 90s, I have become bankrupt company in 20s. So you have to invest with nurturing, with common sense.
Perfectly point taken. So I think, I hope investors are making a note, or all the listeners are making a note of what Nilesh Bhai has to say. I think one of the most lucid and transparent presenters, and he makes it so easy for everyone to understand that it is not difficult to interpret what he's trying to put forth. So Nilesh Bhai, I think the next question, I think gold, Bitcoin, we've been seeing them on a tear. Now, apart from equity allocation, if for an average investor who's starting off in his 30s or mid-30s, with sights on retirement, as all of us have, what should be the ideal allocation, and how much should gold, real estate, or any other asset classes be form a part of the overall asset allocation with that time perspective in consideration?
So, Mahuresh, you have to bet big when you are confident. So, if you are getting a good real estate at bargain prices, it's time to be overweight that real estate.
Yeah.
Second, you also have to take into account impact cost. I had a friend who had bought a piece of land in the outskirts of Mumbai. The land prices shot through. He was very happy. But unfortunately, that land was, you know, occupied by some other people. And it's now in the process of law. So technically, he is owner of that land. But I don't know whether he will make money out of it or not. So when you're investing, you also have to know your limitation. Because someone else made money buying land does not necessarily mean that you will also make money buying land, unless until you can take care of it. The third thing is, you know, instruments like Bitcoin, when they move from $20,000 to $40,000, everyone feels, oh, I should have invested into it. But do you have ability to understand that? Do you have ability to invest into it and take delivery and maintain it? We have heard stories of people who invested into Bitcoin and then their computer crashed and they forgot the key and now Bitcoin is gone. This is despite having a blockchain which proves that he is the owner or otherwise.
Correct.
So one needs to play in that market which he understands. A diversification is important, but please diversify in those assets which you understand. Otherwise, you will enter on a momentum and exit on a momentum. Your confidence to withstand a crisis, to withstand a correction, is the most important point to make money in any asset class.
Absolutely. Absolutely, Nilesh Bhai. So I think, I hope all the listeners are listening to this beautiful piece of advice. Now, coming back, Nilesh Bhai, in terms of what we have been hearing on the themes that you just discussed, there is also this theme of China plus one, which has been playing in the market for the last few months. Whether India will benefit, government has introduced some measures for Atmanirbhar Bharat. So how do you see both aspects in terms of which sectors benefit in terms of the China plus one and the government regulations for the same? And how do you bind the two in terms of finding out the themes which will then stand out over the next 3 to 4 years with this particular angle in perspective?
So I think the PLI scheme announced by government is a fantastic scheme. It has learned from previous mistake. If you remember, Mayuresh, we had textile upgradation fund where we gave concessional financing to people who were setting up textile factory.
Yes.
In that textile upgradation fund, most of the crooked entrepreneurs set up 100 rupee in a factory on paper, over invoiced it to show 1000 rupee, took financing from banks and siphoned off the money.
Yes.
And then their company shut down.
True.
The entire textile upgradation fund's benefit was not felt in Indian economy. This time government is saying that I'm not going to incentivize for putting up a factory. I'm going to incentivize you for what you are producing. This is a big, big difference between textile upgradation fund and PLI. Number two, the world is seeing India as a savior. China gave Wuhan virus. It's fighting with all the neighbors. Clearly, world wants to diversify away from China. They can go to any other country, but India is also one of it. This PLI scheme will hopefully induce more of such people to come to India. We also need to welcome them. In India, we had two examples involving a company called Tata Motors, India's most respected business house. They went to Singur trying to set up an automobile factory, worked very hard to win local people, failed miserably. Eventually, they moved out. While they were moving out, apparently Mr. Ratan Tata got a SMS Suswagatam from Mr. Modi, who was Chief Minister of India, Gujarat then, and now who is Prime Minister. And they moved to Sanand. Land was given, power connection was given, approvals were given, infrastructure was prepared. In about 18 months, Tata Nano factory started rolling out automobiles. We are aware about Elon Musk, Tesla rolling out cars in their factory in China in 12 months. How many of us were aware that in Sanand we did it in 18 months? Now, if whole of India follows Sanand model in welcoming these manufacturers, undoubtedly China plus one will benefit India. If whole of India becomes Singur model and we kick away the investments by virtue of land acquisition, labor, tax terrorism, whatever the case may be, and we have done this in the past, then there is no hope for us. So, stars are aligned for India to benefit. But Indians also have to do the right work. The government has to accord fast approvals. They have to ensure that logistics cost is there, it's reasonable. The tax treatment is fair. I think we have learned from our past, and many states are making a difference. And companies are getting good experience.
Yeah.
There was one wind turbine maker, I'm forgetting the name, but when they came to India before COVID-19, they've said that we have set up our factory in China in 15 months, and we are hopeful that we'll be able to do it in India in a reasonable time frame. In their mind, it was probably 24 or 30 or 40 months. In India, they could set up their factory in 12 months.
Wow.
The entire government machinery worked to ensure that they were able to do it. Now, if we follow that Sanand model, if we follow this wind turbine maker model, then India will definitely benefit.
Wow. Some facts that you put forth, Nilesh Bhai. But specifically, again, I think specialty chemicals as a theme has been on the radar, and stocks have been on a tear there, right? This is one theme that everybody talks about should work in terms of the China plus one, just to continue that question. Or even footwear, or a lot of other sectors where there is also a lot of unorganized aspect at play. So how do you blend the two in terms of both formalization of the unorganized economy into the regulated ones of the listed players, and B, all these aspects playing exponentially in terms of the export opportunities that they can present themselves?
So in some sense, Mayuresh, chemicals, specialty chemicals and contract manufacturing are like technology sector of 2000.
Yes.
In 2000, IT companies got a window of converting double zeros into 2000. And on that entry point, they expanded to create billion-dollar enterprises.
Correct.
Now, the technology sector growth of 20 years is unbelievable. it has exceeded analyst expectation at that point of time.
Yes.
But if you had invested in Wipro at the peak of 2000 price, you had to wait for 20 years to see that price again.
Yes.
Wipro continued to do well, but Wipro share price from that exorbitant price took 20 years to come back. So chemical sector and contract manufacturing both will grow for decades based on current observation. Indian companies have expertise to manufacture chemical on a competitive basis. China is slowing their dominance of chemical sector. Global buyers are interested in diversifying away from China. Indian chemical companies have started investing in expansion, greenfield as well as brownfield. So there is capacity, there is demand, there is capability. Undoubtedly, chemical sector will do well from a growth point of view. We have seen one chemical company who lost out on a multi-million dollar contract, and the management and market rejoiced because that contract was at a slightly lower prices than prevailing prices, and they thought that now this contract gone over the bank and the company compensating, not only there is more money, but you will make more profit. This shows the optimism in chemical sector. The only caution is that prices are factoring in this optimism to a great extent.
Yeah.
So if you are investing in chemical sector from a growth point of view, try to be a long-term investor. In the short term, whenever such kind of optimism is there, there is always possibility of some consolidation or correction.
Oh, absolutely, Nilesh bhai. On the other hand, the commodity cycles, whether you're talking about metals, mining stocks, tea stocks, sugar stocks, Nilesh bhai, how do you play this cycle? I think, do you enter the cycle when the capex is at its optimum level, or do you exit the cycle when the prices are at that all-time high? How do capacities and how do these commodity cycles, if you can explain our viewers on that?
So, someone in lighter vein, when I was asking his advice on commodity investing, told me that you have to buy commodity stocks when they are very, very expensive and sell when they are very, very cheap. And I said, sir, samjhani, ye to aap ekdam ulta bol rahe, mere ko loss nahi karne ka, profit banane ka. Sinesh, I am telling you seriously, you have to buy when they are expensive and sell when they are cheap. I said, but that's not how you make money. You have to buy cheap and sell expensive, right? He said, no, in commodity, it is exactly opposite.
Exactly.
And time has actually proven him right. It is counterintuitive. Yes. When will commodity stock look expensive? When they are loss-making, when their profit is depressed, that's when commodity prices are down.
Yes.
As commodity prices go down, the inefficient players starts moving out,
yes.
Demand starts coming back, and commodity prices recover. Eventually, commodities prices reach very high. They'll make a lot of profit. Valuations will look very cheap. But that's the time when downfall of commodity begins. So number one, commodities cyclical business. You have to play contra to make money in commodity. Buy commodity stocks when commodity prices are down. Sell when they are relatively higher. Will you be able to figure out this was the bottom and this was the top?
Right.
Of course not. So effectively, if you are selling in the top 25 percentile of commodity price, that's good enough. If you are buying in bottom 25% of commodity price, that's good enough. And when commodity prices are in between 50%, if you don't do anything, that's also should work you well.
If you have to put you in a spot, Nilesh bhai, which is the commodity that you'll pick up even in this market condition that the cycle should be turning in their favor over the next few quarters?
So I'll give you an example and then you can, you know, extend it. Cement is a commodity sector.
Yeah.
And we have seen a lot of cycles moving up and down. Now, if someone would have mentioned that in cement, a company like Shree Cement would have delivered almost equivalent return to HDFC Bank, which is a secular story and one of the best, people would not believe. But the reality is that Shree Cement in a commodity sector has delivered same return like a secular company.
Yeah.
How did that happen? It happened because they were extremely cautious on capital allocation. They came out with IPO somewhere in 90s.
Yeah.
And thereafter, they never raised equity capital. Sorry, you'll have to bear with Azan's noise for a while.
Not a problem, management. We want to hear you.
They were extremely cost conscious. They raised all the capital from internal accruals. They funded their expansion from internal accruals. And that capital allocation policy, that cost consciousness, allowed Shree Cement to grow from 500,000 tons to now about 35-40 million tons and create tremendous value for shareholders. So in commodity sector, when you're investing, go for company which is extremely conscious on capital allocation. Go for company which is cost conscious. Go for company which is using internal accruals year after year to expand capacity, and you have the winning formula.
Oh, absolutely, Nilesh bhai. Now, how are you viewing the banking and the financial services sector at this point of time? Because what we've seen in the last few weeks and months of action is that the price action has already started coming in. Q2 numbers were decent, but what's your overall take in terms of this sector, assuming the presumptions that macroeconomic cycle is on a mend, and probably these beta correlated sectors should hopefully do well in such scenarios?
So if you look at banking and financial services sector, again, someone early in life told me that it is the worst sector. And I said, sir, why? He said, in order to earn 2%, you risk 100%. There can't be a bad business than this. And I said, ye baat bhi to sahi hai. So effectively, one must remember that in banking, the tremendous leverage you have can work both ways. If used unwisely, it will kill you. If used wisely, it will benefit you. So number one, always go towards that financial services firm which is extremely conservative on credit side. This is the business where you risk 100% to earn just 2 or 3%. So be with conservative people, not with extravagant, flamboyant person. Number two, this business requires prudence. Any company which is prudent will do well. Now, prudent is not only in terms of conservatism in lending. Prudent is in all forms. Are you prudent in adopting technology? Are you prudent in experimenting with newer products so that you can, you know, kind of connect with customer?
Yeah.
Are you prudent in terms of your capital allocation? There are many PSU banks which have opened branches which are not profitable. Now, that is not prudent. So you have to be with a person who is prudent. Prudent and conservative financial services firm will always deliver value to the investor. There's also a need to differentiate between private sector and public sector. If you see most private sector banks, they have been started, supported, nurtured by people who were working in public sector banks. It's like, suddenly people who were not delivering in public sector bank from a shareholder point of view came to private sectors and started delivering great results. Why is that happening? People are the same, that there is excellent talent in public sector, but they don't produce result if you see the past. That's primarily because they don't have administrative flexibility. In a public sector unit, you will see every 3 year head of treasury shifting. In private sector, 1% will continue for 30 years in treasury. They will build expertise. In public sector, you will see entry level people getting more salary than private sector. But at the top, senior executives getting far less salary than their private counterpart. How will you retain talent? Wouldn't that talent move out whenever they get an opportunity? So net-net, if you put all these things together, my recommendation, financial services, be a long-term investor with a conservative guy, with a prudent guy. overweight private sector over public sector.
Okay.
Public sector undertakings try to buy when they are very, very cheap and sell when they are cheap, rather than, you know, buying cheap and hoping that they'll become expensive. Public sector banks will be more of a trading opportunity. Private sector banks will be more of an investment opportunity.
On that point, Elizabeth. Now, just to continue on that PSU argument, the privatization that the government is trying to do in a few PSU entities, how do you view that? And if it is indeed successful, do you see some re-rating happening for at least a few of the public sector undertakings?
So, Mehuris, if you see Hindustan Zinc Limited, it's the glaring success of public-private partnership and privatization. Hindustan Zinc was a loss-making company in 2002-2003. It was producing 100,000 tons of zinc. It was a drag on exchequer. When it was privatized, Vedanta Group bought it. Today, it makes 1.6 million tons of zinc, 16 times higher in last 17, 18 years. It's contributing 10,000 crore a year to the exchequer in form of royalty, dividend, and taxes. The price at which government sold 51% stake in that company is what they are now getting as dividend on a yearly basis on their 26% residual holding. So Hindustan Zinc demonstrates that public assets given in the hands of private entrepreneurs can create wonder.
Yeah.
Maruti Suzuki is another example. While it was not technically a PSU, but in ownership it was PSU, though it was always run by Suzuki management.
Correct.
It was always a great company, but post-listing it has even become a better company. So clearly, if divestment happens on a strategic basis where private players will be able to utilize public assets, that will be beneficial for economy from all point of view. Instead of taking money from budget, they'll be contributing to the budget. They will be ensuring that India doesn't have to import those things, or we will be able to export things. They will create jobs, employment. They will create better economic growth, and more importantly, they will reward their shareholders.
Oh, absolutely, Nilesh, and I hope that takes place and that takes shape over the next few years, at least from an Indian context. One last sector that I wanted your views on was the FMCG sector. Has largely remained in focus during the pandemic with a lot of in-home consumption, so on and so forth. So how do you view this in terms of cash flows? No doubts, it generates tremendous amount of cash. It throws out free cash flows. Valuations, on the other hand, have always been expensive for the sector as a whole. So how do you see this specifically that we are coming out of the pandemic now? And how do you view the sector from an asset allocation perspective as well?
So FMCG is the defensive sector. It has delivered great return to investors primarily because most of the FMCG company never ever comes out to capital market. You have very little issuances. You have very committed shareholders in institutional as well as retail investors. Their business has secular growth and very high return on equity. Whether we like it or not as consumer, but most FMCG companies have created huge moat courtesy the habits of the consumers. If you are used to a particular brand of soap, toothpaste, you will be continuously using it. It's extremely difficult to move you from your comfort zone. If I'm used to certain level of food, I will experiment, but my belonging to that level of food will always be there. This stickiness of consumer gives secular growth opportunity to FMCG company, higher ROE to FMCG company, and a very good moat to them.
Yeah.
Put all these things together, FMCG companies have continued to reward investors. And despite their sharp run-up, the opportunity still remains. As India moves from, let's say, below $2,000 per capita GDP to more than $2,000 per capita GDP, the consumption pattern will shift. Earlier, roti kapra makan was critical. Now, luxury items will be critical. below 2000, you're spending more on consumer staple. Above 2000, you'll probably spend more on comforts and luxuries like entertainment, education, travel. So keep in mind your shifting pattern of consumption and your relative shifting pattern of consumption, and stay invested in FMCG sector. It will work well.
Great to hear that. So Nilesh bhai, I think budget is around the corner. And if I have to put you on the spot, that if you were the FM, what measures would you have been introducing? Not just the post-pandemic budget that is being presented, but generally, I think, what would be the measures that you would ideally like to see, either from an equity perspective or an economic perspective?
So if I was the finance minister, I would have attempted to achieve impossible. There is a Gujarati saying which says that Nissan chuk maaf, nahi maaf nichu Nissan. Loosely translated, it means you can be forgiven for missing the star, but you can't be forgiven for aiming only at the tree. If you aim at the star, you may not reach there, but you will still reach much higher than the tree. So as finance minister, I will make an honest attempt to achieve impossible. I may fail, but at least I will go out saying that I made an honest attempt. What is this impossible? I will raise revenue without raising taxes. Okay. How will I achieve that? By monetizing government's assets, by plugging tax loopholes, and by becoming open about bringing activities and assets which are in black economy. We all know gold is in black economy. I will create an amnesty scheme so that it can come to white economy. We know people gamble, we know people do betting. I will bring such activity into main economy so that I can tax it and make them responsible industry rather than criminal industry. We know railway is sitting on land, defense is sitting on land, there is transmission tower, there are ports. I will do strategic divestment and monetization of this asset so that I have money with me. Without raising taxes, by improving compliance and by using such things, I will raise enough resources for the government to spend. On the spending side, again, I will focus on supporting those economies which can create multiplier effect. I will support those industries which have been hit badly by COVID-19. And finally, I will ensure that I am maintaining the path of fiscal prudence. I am not burdening my children for my better present. I am not mortgaging my future for my better present. Raising revenues, improving compliance, supporting needy sector of economy, maintaining path of fiscal prudence, these are all conflicting objectives. But with innovation, you will be able to achieve it. You may fail, you may not achieve it 100%, but it is worth attempting.
Great to hear that, Nilesh bhai. And I love the saying that you just pointed out, aim for the stars, not for the trees. So for the paucity of time, I think we could have continued, Nilesh bhai, for the next 2 hours. It has been enriching, very, very thoughtful thoughts from your side. But we'll take 2-3 questions from a lot of investors if time permits. Thank you so much. So I think one of the viewers has a question that we missed out this sector. So the question is on the insurance sector. So how are you seeing the insurance sector, Nilesh bhai? And how do you see the prospects over the next few years?
So one, in insurance, you have life and general. Okay. On the life insurance side, clearly industry will have to go through some amount of restructuring. Today, transparency in insurance industry is far lower. Many insurance companies' profits come from cancellation of policies rather than from running policies. The persistency ratio is a case in point, where if you redeem after 3rd year or within 3 year or 4 year or 5 year, you end up paying. In every industry, the cost of mis-selling is borne by the agent or by the manufacturer. Insurance is the only industry where cost of mis-selling is borne by the consumer. True. This cannot last for long. It will get changed. True. So when you're investing in insurance industry, you need to be careful about certain basic changes which are going to happen at some point of time. True. As investors become more educated, as regulators tighten the space. On the other hand, in general insurance business, there's a great opportunity. 50% of business is still dominated by PSUs. They will keep on losing market share to private sector. And this pandemic has shown us the importance of having appropriate health coverage. So I believe private general insurance will outperform the market, and life insurance will go through that transition. And after that transition, they'll be delivering good return to investors.
Great, great to hear that. Nilendra, one question and one sector that we missed, which viewer has pointed out, is the auto sector. Now, the question here is that there is a lot of transition expected because of EV and that entire cycle. So how are you seeing both the auto and the auto ANC sector, specifically in terms of what will come through from that EV competition perspective as well?
So, see, at the end of the day, Tesla just produced 500,000 vehicles.
Correct.
If you see the overall production of vehicles, that 500,000 doesn't make sense. In India itself, we have 3 million vehicle demand. Now, Tesla's market cap today is $800 billion. It's more than all the automobile companies put together. I was surprised to know when someone informed me that Volkswagen manufactured and sold more electric cars in the month of December than Tesla.
Oh, okay.
I have to check the veracity of this data, but I presume it is from a good source, so it will be right. In the automobile sector, if we look at, we have passenger vehicles, two-wheelers, commercial vehicles, and everything else. Now, if we divide passenger vehicles, clearly COVID-19 has pushed people to buy another car for public, for moving from public transport to private transport. This has preponed demand, and manufacturers are now facing issues of supply, not the demand. Interest rates are down, and it's easy to raise car financing today at a very, very low rate. Mayuresh, I'll have to start charging my iPad, so I will just remove my video.
Yeah, sure.
Now, clearly, passenger vehicle, entry-level passenger vehicle company will do well in the post-COVID era. There is pent-up demand. There is supply constraint. There is huge opportunity over there. In two-wheelers, again, companies which have export market have done well, and companies which have rural focus have done well. Rural market seems to be doing well, and urban market is faltering a little bit. But two-wheeler also will ride on the same concept of personal mobility, moving away from public transport to private vehicle. On the commercial vehicle side, recovery is going to get delayed. Yesterday, I saw the videos of dedicated freight corridor trains moving. Now, dedicated freight corridor is a large project which can materially impact commercial vehicle demand for years to come. So I will be cautious on commercial vehicle, bullish on entry-level passenger car companies, bullish on two-wheeler companies. Then finally, it is tractors. Again, in rural economy, tractors have done well, and most tractor companies' shares have also done well. So tractors, passenger vehicles, two-wheelers, one can pick up. Commercial vehicle, one can avoid.
Super. So I think, I hope all the viewers are listening to what Nilesh Bhai has to say. One more question on the telecom sector, Nilesh Bhai. I think it's looking through over the last few quarters, the Supreme Court hearing, the kind of payments that they need to do now. There's also the news of auctions coming up in the next few months. So how are you viewing this sector, specifically out of home? Data consumption has gone through the roof. Whether you see any price increases happening and whether that benefits the sector over the next few quarters with all these things in perspective. And so especially 5G also coming in.
We have to accept limitation of our abilities. If someone asks you to predict irrationality, there's no way you can predict it.
Correct.
Now, how long company X will continue to incur losses so that they can continue to grab market share
so that they can continue to remain market leader, that's beyond analyst realm.
Yes.
Your logical mind will say that it should stop tomorrow because who wants to lose money? But then, you know, irrationality, you can't predict. Number two, in telecom sector, we also have seen lots of regulatory changes which are unexplainable by rationality and logic. AQR charges, it was a bolt from the blue.
Correct.
And even industry was not aware of it. How can an analyst be aware about it?
True.
So my feeling is that we have to appreciate limitation of our ability and try to enter into telecom sector when maximum pessimism and maximum bad news are around, and try to move out when, you know, a lot of optimism is there. That's probably the most contra way to play telecom sector. In telecom sector, your luck will make money for you, not your skill.
Absolutely, Nilesh bhai. I think last two questions, Nilesh bhai. One is obviously related to what we spoke about in terms of privatization. So what is your take in terms of the entire oil and gas space, whether it's upstream, midstream or downstream companies?
See, in the oil and gas space or energy space in totality,
yes,
clearly there are challenges in terms of fossil fuel versus renewable energy.
Correct.
And like Tesla has shown, concepts can create far more valuation than, you know, something who is having an expiry date. Now, all internal combustion engine, fossil fuel automobiles have an expiry date. Now, whether it's 2030, 2080, 2100, I have no idea. But I know for sure that over a period of time, like horse carriages give way to fossil fuel vehicles will give way to electric vehicles or some other technology.
True.
Keeping that in mind, clearly energy companies have an expiry date on them. World will move from fossil fuel to renewable energy, and there are already countries where 100% of electricity for a day has been met through renewable energy sources. So while investing in energy, do remember that these stocks may look cheap but will remain cheap forever because of this potential expiry date. In very crude sense, you are investing in energy stocks for dividend yield rather than capital appreciation. The second point is on the divestment side.
Yeah.
Clearly, divestment will be beneficial from a shareholder point of view in downstream companies. These companies have great footprint across the nation, but they haven't utilized it innovatively.
Yes.
Globally, if you see, in most petrol pump, there will be a convenience store. And people not only fill the fuel, but also do their shopping. In most petrol pumps in India, you won't even find a convenience store. There are few exceptions, but not all. So clearly it shows that there is a way in which this petrol pumps can be leveraged. And it's more going to happen with a private player than with the government company. So when divestment happens, undoubtedly, downstream companies will become better from a shareholder point of view.
Okay.
The third thing is related to gas, which is a far better, less pollutant fossil fuel compared to petrol or diesel. And clearly in gas, there are lots of technological challenge for moving the gas. And hence someone who has a distribution network, be it pipeline, be it retail outlet, they will have monopoly power, and to that extent, they will have pricing power, and consumers are likely to prefer gas over other fossil fuel. Put all these things together, I think within energy space, gas sector deserves far better valuation and probably be more rewarding to shareholders than privatized downstream companies. And then upstream companies or other fossil fuel companies where you are investing for dividend yield, no longer for capital appreciation.
Great to hear that, Nilesh Bhai. A final question, Nilesh Bhai, and the sector that is in focus right now because of the farmers' protests, agri-related sector. Do you see any incentives getting rolled out in the budget and your take for the entire sector as a whole, including fertilizers, if I have to put that as a part of that?
So again, when 70% of India's vote bank is coming from agriculture and rural, you don't have a choice but to support them. So the budget will definitely talk about what government is doing for farmers. And there is a lot to talk about the direct benefit transfer. For the first time, farmers are getting cash in their bank account. The village roads, for the first time, farmers are actually able to move their products 24/7, 365 days, as village roads have improved. This is not to say that in previous there were no village roads. No. But now village roads quality has improved, connectivity has improved. There's also upliftment of farmers through building of toilets, provision of gas stove, and so on and so forth. Now, if we look at our last 70 years, have we done justice to agriculture sector? There are many bright spots. We were importer of food grains. We were surviving on doles under PL 480. Today, we are exporter of food grain.
Yes.
We have moved from food deficit to food surplus, courtesy farmers of India. We have also seen significant improvement in milk. From being net importer of milk, we have become the largest producer of milk in the world. And today, we can supply milk to the rest of the world.
True. Correct.
Now, apart from this bright spots, what have we done on agriculture side? Our agriculture export is $25 to $30 billion. A country like Netherlands, whose size will be comparable to a small state of India like Haryana, and half of their land is below sea level, they export $80 billion worth of agriculture goods.
Wow.
Clearly, we haven't done a right job on the export side. Why haven't we done right job on the export side? Because we are not reliable trade partner. We allow sugar to export when sugar prices are low. And moment domestic sugar prices go up, we will say don't export. We will allow quota for cotton export when prices are low. But moment prices go up, we will stop it. That's no way to become a reliable trade partner in the world. And hence, we have to have policies which will allow us to become appropriate, reliable trade partner and which will provide export opportunity to farmers.
Yes.
Number two, have we done a good job in managing value add? Clearly, we have one of the best oranges in Nagpur, but there's no Tropicana orange juice brand for India. We have one of the best apples in Himachal, but we still import apples from New Zealand to True. Eat in urban areas.
True.
There is virtually no processing of agri products and supply value added material to global as well as local market. We need to invest in agro industry. Now, why is agro industry not coming up as much as it should come? Look at sugar industry. The government was earlier dictating how much sugar you can sell. They will fix up your selling price as well as raw material price and squeeze you out. With this kind of political intervention, how will agro industry grow? Even the farmers have to blame themselves. And we heard about a multinational company which was buying a particular kind of potato from farmers. Whenever potato prices were low, they will buy from the market and supply with what they had grown. Whenever prices were high in the market, they will say our crop has failed and they will sell in the market. When you shortchange your own partner, it can last for a while. You can make some people full once in a lifetime, but you can't fool all the people all the time.
Correct.
So there is a lot which needs to be done in agri sector. We haven't done justice to our potential in agri sector. However, it gets restricted because of this vote bank politics. The farm laws are the classical example. It's getting protested by people who are getting impacted by it, and it's getting supported by people who are going to benefit out of it. Now, my feeling is that from an investor point of view, while this agriculture sector does provide great opportunity, one has to be extremely careful in investing. The rules, regulations, the way it changes, it does impact business of agri-related companies. And we have seen whether it's guar gum company, whether it's soya company, whether it's basmati rice company, whether it's sugar company, they all have destroyed investor wealth rather than creating wealth.
True.
So be very, very cautious while investing in agriculture sector, because here rationality does not prevail. Here vote bank politics prevail.
Oh, absolutely, Nilesh bhai. And again, for the paucity of time, there are so many questions, Nilesh bhai, if I have to ask you. But I think we'll take it to next time, because that will also give us an opportunity to meet you again. It was very, very insightful, Nilesh bhai. The data points that you put, your thought processes related to a lot of aspects, a lot of sectors that you patiently answered all the queries all about, and your insight in terms of what you've seen. Thank you very much, Nilesh bhai, for gracing this. Okay, we will meet next time, and I hope that this meeting happens in a packed audience without any masks or sanitizers.
Let's hope and pray for a good, happy and healthy 2021.
My wishes. And dear viewers, I think, I hope you had a lovely takeaway what Nilesh bhai had to say. Macros, micros, themes, I think we had covered it all. So thank you so much for attending this. Thank you, Nilesh bhai, for taking time out again, until we meet next time. Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Have a great 2021.